In this short video, our second video regarding the dot product, we're going to derive two important inequalities among two vectors, and then we're going to go back and revisit planes. We're going to look at the Cartesian equation of a plane in a new way in terms of dot products. So our first inequality is called the Cauchy-Schwarz Inequality, named in honor of two mathematicians, Cauchy and Schwarz. And it really comes down to the fact that cosine of theta varies between negative 1 and 1, and we can write that in more compact form by saying that the absolute value of cosine of theta is less than or equal to 1. And so let's start with our dot product formula, that u dotted with v is the length of u times the length of v times cosine theta. And we'll go ahead and take the absolute value of both sides, because we know that u dotted with v could be negative. So now, as a property of the absolute value, I can go ahead and factor out the length of u and the length of v from the right-hand side. And that gives me that the absolute value of u dotted with v is the length of u times the length of v times the absolute value of cosine theta. And this is where I'm going to make use of this inequality up here, that the absolute value of cosine theta is less than or equal to 1, which means that the right-hand side has got to be the left-hand side has got to be less than or equal to the right-hand side. So the absolute value of u dotted with v is always less than or equal to the length of u times the length of v. And in fact, when would we get equality? We would get the equality when cosine of theta equals 1. So we would be able to say that the absolute value of u dotted with v equals the length of u times the length of v only when theta equals 0 or theta equals pi. Well, connected to the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality is the triangle inequality. Whereas the Cauchy-Schwarz has the product of the lengths, the triangle inequality has to deal with the sum of the lengths. And the triangle inequality is not new. You should have seen this in some geometry type class. And it's a very simple idea. It just says that the length of any one side in a triangle, even what we call a degenerate triangle, where there's no interior, the sum of the lengths of the other two sides is always going to be greater than or equal to the length of the third side. So if I take that same idea and apply it to vectors, again, I am going to take my vectors u and v, and now this time, because I'm going to have an addition, I'm going to put the tail of v at the head of u. And so now when I go from the tail of u to the head of v, that is the vector u plus v. So go ahead and take the lengths of each of those vectors, and I can get that the length of u plus v should be less than or equal to the length of u plus the length of v. And only when u and v are parallel and point in the same direction, so u plus v is actually longer than just u, v doesn't go in the opposite direction, then I would say that the length of u plus v equals the length of u plus the length of v. But that's only when u and v point in the exact same direction. So this is an interesting enough inequality that suppose we didn't know this fact from geometry and we'd wanted to prove this inequality. Well, how would we go about it? Well, what we're going to do is whenever we see, again, the length of the sum or difference of two vectors, we're going to start by squaring that, because when you square the length of a vector, it's the same as the dot product of the vector with itself. And we'll go ahead and use FOIL. And from there, we can replace u dotted with u with the length of u squared, and v dotted with a v with the length of v squared. And we can replace u dotted with v with the cosine formula. And so now I've got the length of u squared plus 2 length of u length of v cosine theta plus the length of v squared. And now I'd like to use the fact that, well, any number is less than or equal to the absolute value of that same number. So cosine of theta is going to be less than or equal to the absolute value of cosine theta. So if I replace cosine theta with its absolute value, then the new expression I get is going to be bigger than the expression with just cosine of theta. And then, just like we used with the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, the absolute value of cosine theta is less than or equal to 1. And so then I can say that the expression with the absolute value has got to be smaller than if I just replace the absolute value of cosine theta with 1. So when I put that together, I get the length of u plus v squared is less than or equal to the length of u squared plus 2 times the length of u times the length of v plus the length of v squared. And that, remember these are all scalars, I can actually factor that out as the square of length of u plus length of v. So whenever you have this string, you have to look at the inequalities. And so this can be summarized as saying that the length of u plus v squared is less than or equal to the quantity length u plus length v all squared. So this is not the triangle inequality yet. It's very close because the triangle inequality doesn't have the squares. And so the question is, can I maintain this inequality if I take the square root of each side? And the answer is yes, because y equals x squared is an increasing function when x is positive, which means that whenever a is less than b, then a squared will be less than or equal to b squared if a and b are both positive. And it goes both ways. Whenever a squared is less than or equal to b squared, then a would be less than or equal to b. And so after taking the square root of both sides, I get the triangle inequality. We can also have a new definition taking advantage of these lengths, and it's the distance between two vectors. So the distance between u and v is, if you take u and v and put them tail to tail, what is the distance between the heads of those vectors? Well, the vector that goes from the head of u to the head of v, that's the same as going in the opposite of v and in the same direction as u, that would be the vector u minus v. So the distance between u and v we define as the length of u minus v. And this distance function has some important properties. All distance functions share these properties, that you have symmetry or a commutative type property, that the distance between u and v should be the same as the distance between v and u, and that is the case. You have homogeneity, which means you can factor out a scalar, and we have a triangle inequality. The distance between u and w is going to be less than or equal to the distance from u to v plus the distance from v to w. Now let's shift gears here and look at planes again using our dot product. So let's go back to the beginning here. A plane of passing through the origin represents the span of two non-parallel vectors in R3. So, for example, if you have two vectors, the first vector with components 1, negative 2, 5, the second vector has components 2, 3, negative 1, we know we can derive a Cartesian equation, and one of those Cartesian equations would be negative 13x plus 11y plus 7z equals 0. You know, it equals 0. We saw that it equals 0 because it's passing through the origin, which means when I put x, y, and z equal to 0, of course, it has to equal 0. But I can rewrite that equation in terms of the dot product. I can take the coefficients and put them in one vector, and the x, y, z can be another vector. And what does that say? That says that any vector, so x, y, z, the vector with components x, y, z, represents the position vector of any point in the plane. So that tells me that the position vector of any point in the plane is going to be orthogonal to this vector with components negative 13, 11, and 7. This vector with components negative 13, 11, and 7, remember those are just the coefficients a, b, and c from the Cartesian equation, we usually use n to denote that vector, and it's called the normal vector. So if you've taken multivariable calculus, then you're familiar with the notion of normal. Or if you've taken a basic physics class, you may have seen a normal force. And normal in this case means orthogonal or perpendicular. And if you take the line through the origin, parallel to the normal vector, that is called the normal line. So let's try to look at a picture here. I realize this picture is not the best one I've made, but it represents a plane passing through the origin. We have the position vector OP of some point. P is a point on the plane, so OP is my position vector of that point, and it's going to be orthogonal to the normal vector. Every vector in that plane is orthogonal to the normal vector. And so for any point in the plane, then the dot product of those two would have to be 0. Or again, if we have the components of the normal vector being a, b, and c, then we get our familiar Cartesian equation ax plus by plus cz equals 0. Now that's fine and not really new. We've seen that before in terms of planes passing through the origin. But what if I move the plane? And so in this case, it's a translation, and we call it a translate. We are moving every point in the plane through the vector with components x naught, y naught, z naught. So for example, the origin gets moved to the point Q whose coordinates are x naught, y naught, and z naught. And so the orientation didn't change of the plane. So in other words, our normal vector remains a normal vector. Still, every vector that lies in the plane is still orthogonal to the normal vector n. But notice that now our position vector of a point in the plane no longer lies in the plane, in the translate of the plane. When it's passing through the origin, the position vector is in the plane, but if we translate it away from the origin, then the position vector of that point now does not lie in the plane. But if I look at where did we go translate the origin to? We translated it to Q. So instead of going from the origin, let me go to from point Q to point P, the translate of the origin to point P. That vector does lie in the plane. And what are the components of that vector? Well, instead of having x, y, and z, I have x minus x naught, y minus y naught, z minus z naught. That vector should be orthogonal to the normal vector. So again, having a translatable plane is not new. We saw this before. This was our general equation that we had this initial vector plus a linear combination of two vectors, two non-parallel vectors. Well, I could just subtract the x naught, y naught, z naught from each side, and I get now the translate of that point is a linear combination of u and v. So all I've done is replaced add the position vector x, y, z with its translate, x minus x naught, y minus y naught, and z minus z naught. So then we say that that translate is orthogonal to the normal vector, so its dot product will be 0. And I can do some algebra with that. I could break the x minus x naught, y minus y naught, and z minus z naught into two vectors. And then that will give me that n dotted with x, y, z is n dotted with x naught, y naught, and z naught, which brings us back to our familiar Cartesian equation. If I write the components of the normal vector as a, b, c, then I will get ax plus by plus cz equals d, where d is the dot product of the normal vector with a specific vector or initial vector on the plane. So I hope you found that this is useful. This is probably a more familiar way of looking at planes if you had a multivariable calculus class before taking linear algebra. But if you didn't, this is an important way for us to think about planes in R3.